Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Welcome on this Labor Day weekend. It's nice to have a holiday. Anybody getting have the day off on Monday? Raise your hand. All right, well, there's a few of us, or a few of you. We're here to see, you know, we sometimes call Sunday a Sabbath day, more an Old Testament Saturday was Sabbath. We call Sunday the Lord's Day. We're resting from our labor today as well. We're here and we've got one purpose. We're here to glorify God. We're here to lift up his name. We're here to receive from him. So if we'd come and we do that together, I can tell you one thing, God's presence is going to be here. Let's worship him.
Stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great and how awesome is he. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God We bow down and worship him now. How great and how awesome is he. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. We sing, holy is the Lord. All around, it's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. Yes, it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising. Together
we sing.
Oh, everyone sing. Oh, sing, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Sing, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
Praise God, praise God, praise God. Is he giving you a song in your heart? Amen, hallelujah. He keeps me singing. Hallelujah, glory to God. No matter what's going on, I still got a song in my heart. And I sing about Jesus. How about you? Amen. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's worthy to be praised Come on and just praise his name right now. Give him glory in the house. Give him praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we thank you so much for your presence that we sense in our midst. And Lord, we ask, oh God, that you would have your way in our midst. Lord God, let none of us leave the same we came this morning, having been touched by Spirit of God. Fall fresh on every heart, every life. Oh God, move in a mighty way. We'll see souls saved, lives touched in a mighty way. And Lord, we want to pray right now, Lord, for the Christians in Afghanistan. God, oh God, you know. Lord God, we're asking you to keep your protective hand upon each and every one. You know all about it there. We don't have to, Lord, we don't have to remind you or tell you what you see. Yes, but Lord, you are still on the throne. You're still on the throne, oh Lord God. So we're looking to you, God, to have your way. And Lord, so we just pray, and we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. 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 Praise God. Let's just continue to worship the Lord. Glory.
Before we start our worship again, why don't you turn and greet someone, welcome them to church today. It's good for us to be together as family. We're going to worship him.
Praise him, you heavens and all that's above. Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the whole earth praise him.
Come on, praise him.
Shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies. Let the whole earth praise him.
Oh, he's great in power, great in glory, great in mercy. He's the King of heaven.
Let the earth rejoice, and let up all his enemies. The hills melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. At the presence of the Lord.
Before the world began, and he who
throughout eternity. Oh, we're never gonna stop praising the name of the Lord. He died for you. He was risen for you. He brings healing for you. Oh, Rasanda Baba Kishayatopo. Break down the walls in our hearts today, Lord. Show us who you truly are. Show us your presence, God. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again.
Oh, sing that again out loud to him. I'm forgiven.
I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken. I'm accepted,
Lord.
You were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you.
Oh, amazing love,
amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me?
Oh,
amazing love, Lord, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned.
Lord,
I'm alive and well, and your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Oh, amazing love, how can it be
that you, my King,
that you, my King, would die for me?
Oh,
amazing love, Lord, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you.
Amazing love,
how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, Lord, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do.
In everything that I do,
I honor you.
I honor you
in all I do. I honor you.
Just take a moment and honor the Lord with your praise today. Oh, he is worthy. Jesus, you are here. Move among your people today. Bypass the walls we built up. Speak to our hearts. Jesus, oh Lord. Presencia, tu gloria, bienvenido aquí. Todo honra, dominio, arsecate, te quiero. Te amo, vivimos para glorificar tu nombre. Your presence, your glory, your all honor, dominion, Lord, please come near. We want you, Lord, we need we you. Need you. Oh, we live to glorify your name.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated, everyone.
Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. We glorify your name. We magnify your name. Sweet Jesus. We want to thank you, Lord, that you love us, that you care so much about us. At this time, we want to open up these altars, ask our prayer team to come forward. And if you have a need this morning, whatever that need is, certainly you know that God is well able to meet that need. There's nothing impossible with him. And so if you'll come, amen, and we have people that will, amen, pray with you, agree with you, anoint you with oil if you're sick in body. And listen, this is a time where, you know, like I said, the altars are open, but more than that, God's here. Amen. He's in the house. And, you know, I just love the fact that he hears our cry. And he's moved by our infirmities. He's, you know, and I don't know about you, but, you know, having this confidence that when we, you know, talk to God and we cry out to him, that, you know, he hears us. And he's moved by us. Amen. So listen, you have a need today? Why don't you just come and just receive what God has for you today? Amen. While Don continues to play, come on, get out of your seats and amen, and just meet with God. Lord, we also want to pray for those who are watching online. Lord, those wherever they're at, oh Lord, that they have a need today. We're asking you, Lord God, because you're everywhere present and nowhere is absent. You know right where they are. And Lord, we're just asking you to move on their behalf, whatever the need is. Lord, to just touch them and as only you can. And Lord, may they give testimony. May they shout it out. Look what the Lord has done. We need to hear, Lord God, about what you're doing more and more and more, Lord God. So we just want to give you praise for what you're doing and what you're yet going to do. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children said,
amen.
Amen. Praise God. We'd like to welcome anybody here for the first time this morning. Anyone at all? Listen, you know what? Let's invite somebody. Amen. Next week. I know that some people have already. You know, Lucy was telling me she invited her family, and keep doing it. Don't get discouraged. You know what I mean? Ask and you shall receive. Isn't that what the word says? Amen. So praise God. And I look out into the sanctuary, and I want to thank you for praying for me, for the operation on my eyes. I can see every one of you. Praise the Lord. You know, I was 11 years old, and I've been wearing glasses or contacts, you know, since I was 11. I am now 78, and I got 20/20 vision. Praise the Lord. Isn't that God? God is good. Praise his name. Praise his name. Hallelujah. It's time to continue to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Amen. And is it glad? I'm glad that we can, rejoice and be glad, amen. And, you know, I say this often, we can never outgive God. And so as you prepare to give, amen, give with a cheerful heart and just get up out of your seats, amen, and just come. And ushers, if you'll come to get ready to receive of our tithes and offerings. Again, let me remind you that, Lord, is to, you know, most of it, it is to pay the bills and everything else, but also to be able to reach out to the community. You know, the extra that we have and whatever is to continue to continue to do that. To reaching out is so vitally important to let the community all around know that there is a God in heaven who loves them, who cares about them. Amen. And He's not only just asked us; He's commanded us to do that, to go out and witness. Amen, to tell people, amen. in any way that we can. So we just give him praise and glory. Lord, thank you, Lord God, that we can, Lord, come and give of our tithes and offerings. And that is our heart today, that, Lord, that we may use, Lord, these finances to further your kingdom, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Oh, rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day it's coming back. Glorious day. Oh, one day when heaven was filled with his praises. One day when sin was as black as could be. Oh, Jesus came down.
Well, glory.
Born of a virgin. Dwelt among men. My example is he. Oh, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Oh, and rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day he's coming back. Glorious day. Oh, one day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Oh, suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Oh, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Oh, and rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day he's coming back. Glory, I say. Oh, one day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Oh, then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, he's my Lord evermore. Oh, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Carried my sins far away. Oh, rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day he's coming back. Glorious day. Oh, one day the trumpet's gonna sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Oh, what a wonderful day, my beloved one's free.
Well, glory.
Glorious Savior, this here Jesus is mine. Children. Oh, living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me.
Buried, he carried my sins far away.
Oh, and rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day he's coming back. Glorious day. Oh, I say living, he loved me.
Well,
dying, he saved me.
Glory.
Buried, he carried my sins far away. Oh, and rising, he justified. Freed me forever. Oh, one day he's coming back. Glorious day.
God, praise thank God, praise God. Yes, shout glory. You know, one day when I'll get to heaven, in that heavenly choir, and everybody's going to sing, they're not going to worry about, you know, that's not all we're going to do, but we're going to just praise the Lord for eternity. Oh, what a glorious day. Well, praise his name, praise his name. Yes, come on, shout. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory, glory, glory. My, my. Oh, come on, church. Glory to God, glory to God. He'll give you a spring in your feet, amen. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost will set your feet a-dancing. My, my. That's an old song. I know you don't know, but anyway, it's good. Praise God. Praise God. It's time to dismiss our children, amen, as they go to your children's church. And praise God. We thank the leaders. That give it. I say this often because it's, you know, we need leaders. We need people to do this, but to train our children and to let them to know God and you know at an early age and to serve Him. That's a great thing, and we're so glad that we have help to do that. Amen. And so, children, you are dismissed. You're free to go and have a great time and learn about Jesus. Amen. Father, we want to thank you so very much for this opportunity, Lord, that we can give our children. Lord, to go and have a good time, but Lord, have fun, but also learn about you. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Let me leave you with some announcements. Tuesday night prayer meeting starts at 7 p.m. You're welcome to come. and gather together, amen, and just seek the face of God for not only the needs, but for the needs of the world. I mean, we just, you know, it's not just us. It's people need the Lord. Amen. And so you want to come. Riverside Youth Group restarts this Friday evening at 6:30 p.m. Praise God. Hallelujah. We worship for preschoolers and toddlers will be available next week, September 12th. Children must be registered on the Kid Check C-Bulletin for more info. Women's Ministry meets Sundays at 8 a.m. and Men's Ministries meet on Thursday nights at 6:30 p.m. Both groups are meeting online, okay? A Riverside Church sign is in need of repair and upgrading. This project will cost approximately $4,000. We will be taking up an offering on Sunday, September 19th, to help offset those costs. You're going to, like I said, we've seen it. You're going to love it. Amen. It's different. We have a different insignia, and it's really, really good. So praise the Lord. Pastor Dan is looking for individuals to join the worship team, including vocalists. If you are interested, please see the bulletin for more information. Did you get anyone yet?
Not yet.
Yes, I did. Yes. Not yet. Oh, come on, church. I mean, I hear you all singing, right? So what's the difference between singing there and singing here? You're in God's house. Oh, I like the way you're shouting now. Come on. Come on, church. Let's get with it. Amen. Praise. Don't you love to sing and praise the Lord? Amen. And if you got some kind of a guitar or something, I'm sure you're more than welcome. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. We're also, Riverside is looking for some help to help live stream our services if you are interested. I know we've got, three or four people that are, but we need more to learn. It's not hard to do, but we need some help there in order to be able to live stream our services. It'd be a great thing. Amen. So you just pray about it. Take about maybe 15 minutes to pray and then do something. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on, church. Hallelujah. Pastor Dan's going to come. Praise God.
I like that. Take some time to pray and then do something. Too many times we stop with just the prayer. Hey, speaking of prayer, I thank everybody for helping me with your prayers. We're still working on getting my back all fixed up. I had an MRI yesterday, and so hopefully this week they'll find out exactly what's going on with me. So I appreciate your continued prayers as we try to figure out what's up. But when I'm sitting down, I'm just fine, which is one of my favorite things to do anyway. So there you have it. That's perfectly fine. We're glad that you're here today as Pastor Dick. And this, I'll be honest, this is the last time we're going to put that in our announcements as far as our live streaming. We're just needing somebody basically to help with manning the camera and just getting everything connected in the mornings. It's not something that you need a great deal of tech savvy. We'll help you. We'll get you set up for that. In doing so, it would help us with our lives to live stream instead of recording and then editing and then uploading. It takes many hours to do that, and that would save us a whole lot of time. But I'm glad you're here today, here on a Labor Day weekend. You could be driving up to the mountains, and if people are driving up to the mountains or to the beach, that's fine. But I'm glad that we're here together as a family. We can worship God together. I don't know about you, but I do not like commercials. I just don't. I mean, the good thing today is if you've got like a streaming service or you're recording your shows and then watching them, so you can just fast forward through commercials and just zip zip zip. Zip. I got like a little 30-second button on my and just boop 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 boop. And get through the commercials. younger people perhaps don't understand that there was a time we couldn't do that. We had to sit through every single commercial. We could maybe turn the volume down. But also, I guess commercials were good because if you wanted to get a snack, you could get up and go get a snack. And of course, now we can just pause things. But I don't like commercials. So many hair products and new prescription drugs with warning labels that go on and on and on. But when they started putting commercials in movies, when at the beginning of movies, you know, you go to the movie theater and before the movie comes on, it used to be just previews or trivia questions. I liked those things, but now it's more commercials, and I can't fast forward that one. So, you know, I'm not in a hurry anymore to get to the movie theater just on time for the film. You know, I'd rather stand in the popcorn line than watch an ad for Sprite or to buy a new Lexus or something. But there have been some memorable commercials in my lifetime, certainly. For instance, let's look at this picture of this kid here on the next one. Anybody remember what he was selling? Anybody old enough? Not quite. The right company. Bologna, that's right. He sang a song. He said, "My bologna has a first name. It's O-S-C-A-R. Bologna has a second name. It's M-M-E-Y-E-R. Love to eat it every day. And if you ask me why, I'll say, Oscar Mayer has a way with B-O-L-O-G-N-A. And when I was a kid, that's how I learned to spell bologna. Because of this kid on the commercial. It was memorable. And then there was this elderly woman who asked all of America, "Where's the beef? Where is the beef? Because of the big buns and little tiny hamburgers, where's the beef?" she asked. And then this little lizard told me how to buy cheap insurance in 15 minutes or less. And then there was this pink bunny that just kept going on and on and on because of his batteries. Those are things that were drilled into our heads as advertisements, weren't they? In the 1990s, Kellogg's came out with an advertising slogan, a well-done commercial campaign. It was for their cereal, Corn Flakes, Kellogg's Corn Flakes. Now, Corn Flakes had been around since 1894, so it wasn't anything new. It was one of the first breakfast cereals. But Kellogg's looked, you know, 100 years later, and there's a whole supermarket aisle just full of different cereals, different choices. Cereals with different colors and shapes, and cereals with marshmallow and fruit, and cereals with cartoon characters, and cereal with toys inside. And there, you know, usually on the bottom shelf somewhere, were those poor boxes of Kellogg's Corn Flakes. Well, their sales were sagging, and so Kellogg's developed this ad slogan. It was this: Kellogg's Corn Flakes, taste them again for the first time. And it worked. Sales started to go up because it drew upon the nostalgia that people have. They remembered when they were young, when they were kids, and they said, "Oh, yeah, Corn Flakes. I haven't had Corn Flakes in so long." It was a simple cereal for a simpler time. And Kellogg's was saying, "Hey, remember that good feeling you used to have as a kid? Remember that good feeling you used to have when you were eating cornflakes? Well, try them again. That feeling is still there. And you can, because these cornflakes, they haven't changed in 100 years. Well, with so many things to distract us, sometimes we take our relationship with God for granted. We forget the love and the passion that we had for him that first time. And I'm here to tell you today, taste and see that the Lord is still good. Remember that good feeling? Try him again, because he hasn't changed. We're at the beginning of our study of the book of Revelation. And last time we saw the beginning of the vision that John had. We saw the Holy Spirit was open to the voice. How John was open to the voice of God because he had been worshiping in the Spirit. And how the glory of Jesus kind of overwhelmed him. Well, this week, the book of Revelation brings a message to the church in Ephesus. A message of warning because they've lost their first love. a message of how to regain that first love and the paradise that awaits those who persevere until the final chapter. Let's pray. God, I thank you for your scripture. I thank you for the book of Revelation. I thank you for your touch upon our hearts already today in service. God, I have felt you move in this place. And so I know you're here. Thank you for that reminder. And I ask, Lord, that you would use that experience that we've had already. Like John, the Revelator, had been in the Spirit when you spoke to him. As we have been in the Spirit here this morning, speak to our hearts. Let us learn from you and be drawn closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you remember back to Daniel and the people of Israel had been exiled to Babylon. They had been separated from the land of Israel, and the king of Babylon brought them up to Babylon so they wouldn't be down there in Israel causing trouble. But the people found that even in Babylon, God was still with them. Well, John the Revelator has been exiled as well, this time to the island of Patmos. And he was separated from the mainland of Asia Minor so that he wouldn't be causing trouble over in Asia Minor preaching the gospel over there. But on the island, John as well experiences the reality of God because God is still with him there on that island. It was a Sunday, and John was kind of having his own church service there on the island. Maybe he's down on the beach. He's worshiping God when suddenly God shows up. And a vision of Jesus stood before John and told him, write down all that you're about to hear and see. Jesus said that he had a message that was for the seven churches in Asia Minor. I have these messages for them. I want you to hear them. And this message is going to contain a pattern of trials and temptation and perseverance that's going to be of immediate importance to those seven churches in Asia Minor. But that pattern of trials and tribulation and perseverance, that pattern is going to continue throughout the age of the church. And it's going to continue all the way until the final chapter of this world. And that's why that message is important for us today, because we live through those same patterns. We live through those same trials. So as Jesus continues his instructions to John, he begins to do what he said he was going to do. He addresses the seven churches individually. Now, each message is a personal message to that church that Jesus is giving. See, Jesus is aware of each of those churches and each of the situations. They're individual churches, individual cities, individual situations. And Jesus sees all of them. And he knows exactly. It's not just one message for all seven churches. He's got a specific message for each of them, just like he's got a specific message for each of us. But there is an overarching message that does apply to all the churches. There is this universal call that we're going to see for the seven churches to be faithful, to persevere, to keep going, to endure their situations until the promise is fulfilled, and that then they will be united with Christ in his new kingdom. Now, the message from Jesus to the seven churches all contain kind of a similar pattern, that is similar for each church. The first thing he addresses is a description of himself. He addresses himself to the church and gives a description of himself, Jesus does. The second thing he does is he will give the strength of the church. Here's the good things that you're doing, and I appreciate them. The third thing is he's going to give the weaknesses of the church. Here's the thing that is you guys need to work on. Here's the thing that you guys need to take care of. And then in the final point, he gives instructions to the church and the promise that's going to come if they fulfill those instructions. So we'll see this basic pattern in each of the seven churches that Jesus addresses in Asia Minor. And the first message that Jesus gives, he begins by giving a message to the church in the city of Ephesus. Ephesus. We have a whole book called Ephesians written to that church. Well, Ephesus is a major port city, and it's the seat of power for the appointed governor. The governor of Asia Minor spends his time there in Ephesus. There are huge temples there. Temples to the emperor, temples to the Greek goddess Artemis are there in Ephesus. And this is how Jesus, again, remember that pattern. This is how Jesus addresses and describes himself to the church in Ephesus. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks along the seven golden lampstands. To the angel? Who's this angel that Jesus is talking about? Listen, this is one of many times in the book of Revelation that I'm going to tell you I'm not exactly sure. Now, the Greek word angelo means literally a messenger. So what it literally says there, to the seven stars, rather the seven messengers are in his hand. So some people suggest that there's an angel assigned to each of the seven churches. Each of the seven churches have kind of a guardian angel, and that's very possible. There are other scholars who suggest that the messengers here refer to the pastors of those churches because the pastor is a messenger of the word, and that's also very possible. But rather than get distracted by the identity of the angel, let's look instead at the one who is sending the message. He who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven lampstands. Jesus is showing his authority here, that he holds in his hand and walks among the churches. He's addressing this church in Ephesus, and he's saying, hey, guys, I'm in charge. I hold the messengers in my hands. I walk along the seven churches, watching them, loving them, empowering them. He is the one in authority, so you better listen to what he's about to say. Jesus then addresses the strengths. This is going to be the good news for the Ephesian church. Verses 2 and 3 of chapter 2. I know your works, your toil and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. These are some great things you guys are doing, Ephesus. You guys are doing great with your doctrine, your teaching. You're working hard. You're persevering in the midst of trials, especially in the midst of this pagan city. And your doctrine is sure. Doctrine means your teaching, the truth that you're teaching. Jesus is saying to them, you're doing a good job with this. Everything you're teaching is good. But perhaps they're a little too focused on the truth and not focused enough on the truth giver. Because let's look what Jesus says as far as the weaknesses of this church. Verse 4. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Jesus saying, remember the way things were at the beginning? Remember when your heart was committed and passionate? Remember when there was nothing that could come between us? Jesus is saying, I miss that because it's gone. This happens in marriages too, doesn't it? I think it's pretty common, the loss of the first love. But listen, it doesn't have to be that way. Love can continue to grow and evolve and deepen and develop. So Jesus gives them some instructions to rekindle that first love, to rekindle that fire of passion that you had. Jesus says, here's what you need to do. Revelation 2:5. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. So there's kind of three instructions, a threefold instruction. Jesus says, first of all, remember. Remember the way it used to be. Ephesian church, think back about how things were when you first came to me. And second, repent from the direction you're going, because right now you're going away from your first love. I want you to repent. That means turn around from the way you're going and turn back and do the things you used to do. Remember those things you used to do when you were passionate about me. Remember those things you used to do when you had your first love, and do those things again. By the way, these are pretty good instructions for someone who feels that they've lost their first love in their marriage. Remember how it used to be. Repent of the way it is now and start doing those things you used to do at the beginning. But here Jesus is looking for the Ephesian church to find their first love again so that they can have a growing and deepening relationship with him. And this is a serious problem. Jesus is saying your doctrine is not good enough. The fact that you've got good teaching, that's not good enough. If there's not a compassionate relationship with Jesus, then their place will be removed. They will no longer be a true church of Jesus Christ. And in this particular instance, Jesus gives them another piece of encouragement, Revelation 2:6. Yet this you have, you hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Who are the Nicolaitans? I don't really know. For the Bible, they're only mentioned in the book of Revelation two or three times. And that's it. There are some theories about what they were, that they were followers of because there was a deacon called Nicholas in Acts chapter 7, and maybe he kind of went off the wrong way and started preaching some false doctrine. There's some that say they are very hedonistic and such, but that's the only place that they're mentioned. So obviously, no matter what the specifics were, there were some sort of offshoot group, possibly claiming to be apostles, as we saw earlier in this chapter, possibly claiming to be apostles, but they were teaching false doctrine. Obviously, their influence was felt in Asia Minor, including in the Ephesian church. And that false teaching of the Nicolaitans, whatever it was a poison. It is a contagion that threatens spiritual disaster and spiritual death to others. But thanks to their knowledge of who God is, remember God was saying you're great with your doctrine. Thanks to their knowledge of what God's word is, the church in Ephesus was able to recognize these guys' teaching, it's false. And they were able to stop the spread of that spiritually destructive infection in their city. And finally, Jesus gives that promise to the church in Ephesus. Revelation 2:7. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. He who has an ear. Raise your hand if you have an ear. All right? Well, most of you. Okay? So if you have an ear, you need to listen to this. This is written. John is writing this down. Jesus is saying this. So he's saying it, yes, to the church of Ephesus, but to all who will read this then and in the future. If you have an ear, in fact, you have two of them. If you have an ear, listen to what the Spirit is saying to the church. He's saying this: if you conquer the loss of your first love, if you overcome the tribulation that you are facing, there is a great reward for you. You get to partake of the tree of life. We're going to see the tree of life way at the end of the book of Revelation sometime next year. But this tree is in the city of New Jerusalem by the crystal flowing river from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And the tree bears its 12 kinds of fruit, and even the leaves of the trees heal the nations. It is a tree that brings unity. It is a tree that brings peace. It is a tree that brings eternal life. And so God is saying, be perseverant. Be faithful. Because if you get there, you will have peace, unity, and life forevermore. Because the final chapter is coming. As it says in The Last Battle by C.S. Lewis, this life that we live is just the cover and the title page of the great story. And when the king returns, we're going to begin with chapter one. And this great story goes on forever, and each chapter is greater than the one before. What lessons can we take from what we've heard today in the Spirit's addressing of the Church of Ephesus? What can we take home and appreciate, but more than appreciate, apply, and more than apply, do? Like Pastor Dick said, pray and then do something. What can we do here? What can we take home and do? Let me share with you the lessons that I'm taking away here from the first part of Revelation chapter 2. First is this. Good doctrine does not save you. Good doctrine does not save you. The Ephesians were committed to their doctrine. They were committed. They wanted to be right about everything. They had the sound teaching about who God was. If you met somebody from the church of Ephesus, they could explain to you the meaning of Jesus' sacrifice. They could explain probably the purpose of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you sat on a bus next to somebody from the church of Ephesus, they might be able to tell you how God's sovereignty and man's free will can exist at the same time. But despite all that, their faith was dry. Like my throat was just a second ago. Their passion had gone. They were right in their doctrine. They were right in their teaching. But they were just going through the motions. The light of Christ might have been in their words, but it was not in their spirits. You might have a masterful grasp of God's word. You might be able to tell me exactly how salvation works. You might be able to tell me what the relationship is of the members of the Trinity. You might be able to give me details about the different spiritual gifts, but I can tell you that that knowledge does not save you. It is your relationship to Jesus Christ that saves you. The truth will only set you free if you apply that truth to your life. And Jesus is the truth. And like any other relationship, our relationship with Jesus, it fluctuates because we're human. It's difficult to sustain the passion of that first love. The problem that Jesus is addressing here with Ephesus is that they are losing that first love altogether. They're allowing that passion to slip from their grasp, and that problem can be for us as well, when we let the passion, that first love, slip from our grasp, when our faith starts to become dry and cold. This happens gradually as we hit those low times, but then we do nothing of effort to change it. The low time gets longer and longer, and the passion dies. But thankfully, Jesus himself gives us the answer to the problem. And that answer is the next lesson I'm taking away from this message to the Ephesian church, and it's this. Remember, repent, and do. Remember, repent, and do. The instructions for us are the same as the instructions for the Ephesian church. If you find yourself in a similar problem where your heart is dry, where you feel like you don't have that first love anymore, then that solution is the same, and it is a simple equation. Revelation 2:5, we'll read it again. Remember, therefore, where you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. So first, remember what it used to be like. Remember when you were so grateful for what Jesus did in your life. Remember when you couldn't help but praise him. Remember when you couldn't help, you just had to tell others about what Jesus had done for you. Remember that height from which you've fallen. And then the second step is to repent from where you are. You don't have to say, okay, I've got to get back there first. Listen, that next step isn't to try to crawl back on your own. That next step is to repent, to say, Jesus, look at where I am now. This is not where I should be. Turn around from that direction that you're going, because your forgiveness has already been paid for by Jesus. Jesus doesn't need to be crucified again. Your forgiveness is already paid for. If you are a Christian, God's forgiveness is immediate. But you can't expect a change in your relationship if you don't turn around from the way that you're walking now. You've got to turn around back to the relationship so that you can get closer to Him. Repentance is that commitment to say, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm committed to doing better. And then the third part of the equation is to do what you used to do. Do the things you did when your first love was vibrant in your heart. You couldn't get enough of God's word. You studied it alone. You studied it with others. You prayed. You shared your faith. Jesus is saying, do these things again. Do those again in order to regain your first love. And you may say, yeah, but I'm so dry, I don't really feel like reading my Bible. I don't care. Do it anyway. This isn't about how you feel. This is about your relationship with Christ. Do it anyway. And I guarantee you, you will find your faith built up. You will find your first love returning. You will find your relationship with Christ healed. Here's a third lesson I'm taking away. Good doctrine is a defense against false teaching. Good doctrine is a defense against false teaching. The church of Ephesus may have had some passion problems, but at least they didn't fall to the false teaching of the Nicolaitans, which we'll see soon other churches did. It was a teaching that maybe that they heard that teaching of the Nicolaitans, and maybe it sounded righteous. Maybe they coached it in Christian terminology so that it sounded Christian. But at the root of that teaching was a false representation of who God is and how He deals with His people. It was a false teaching. And the Ephesians were able to say, wait a minute, that's not right. They were able to spot that false teaching and avoid it. And they were able to do so because of their good doctrine, their good teaching. The Ephesians were solid in the Scripture. They knew the Scripture. They understood the Word of God and its context. They knew that the Word provided all they needed for their instructions and their growth. So their doctrine alone didn't save them, but it did stop them from falling into that false heretical teaching. Good, solid, scriptural teaching provides the same for us today. When we know God's truth, we recognize the things that are false. Even if that false teaching claims to be God's truth, we will still recognize it because we've had good teaching. And listen, that good teaching doesn't just come from the pulpit or from a guy sitting on a stool. That good teaching comes from Sunday school classes. That good teaching comes from Bible studies, meeting together with men and women. That good teaching comes when you gather together over coffee at a Dunkin' Donuts and say, let's read the Bible together. That good teaching comes when you sit with two or three friends in your basement and open up a devotional and open up the Word of God and say, let's see how we can apply that to our lives. That kind of good teaching can happen anywhere. When the people of God gather together and say, let's look at what the Word says. There are a myriad of available options for you to learn more about the Scripture. This will help you to more readily recognize false and dangerous doctrines. Because like we said last Wednesday night, everybody's got a YouTube channel. Anybody can publish a book. Anybody can proclaim some doctrine that's false. But if you know God's truth and know the Word of God, you'll be able to recognize what's false. But not just that. It will help you to grow closer to the author of Scripture. If you know the Word, you know the author. Through His Holy Spirit, the Father will speak to your heart through your study of the Word of God, that the Bible is there to direct us and challenge us and teach us and protect us, and maybe more than anything else, to tell us that God loves us and He's there with us and He will always be there with us. Here's the last lesson I'm taking away from the book of Revelation today. The tree of life awaits us. The tree of life awaits us. I was studying and doing some work on the sermon, and it must have been before school started, because Christina and Samuel were sitting there with me, and Christina looks over and says, "What's wrong?" And I'm crying because we get to eat from the tree of life. Is Jesus disappointed with the Ephesian church because they've lost their first love? Yes, absolutely. But He also gives them the reassurance that you can overcome this current dry spell in your faith. You can do this. He gives them the reassurance that with His help, they can persevere and overcome the coming trials and tribulations. And Jesus gives them some pretty positive incentive. If you conquer them, if you conquer these things, you're going to be in paradise with Me. And you get to partake of the tree of life, the tree that heals our hearts and brings us together, the tree which gives us immeasurable joy and peace. And people of Riverside, Church of Riverside, that promise is for you too. That promise is available for you. If you conquer the things that threaten your relationship with Christ, if you persevere to the end, the fruit of the tree of life and all its benefits is available to you. You will experience all the and relish all the richness that it provides. This is the final chapter for this earth. Revelation is going to describe the falling action, the denouement of history here. But our entry into paradise, it's just the beginning of the story. A story that never ends. That is the promise for all who persevere. And we can persevere because Jesus is with us. We can't do it on our own. But with Jesus' help, we can make it through. We can overcome. We can be conquerors. And we can enter into paradise with Him. If you're worried about that, if you are worried about, I've never given my heart over Jesus, but it sounds like I want to be in paradise, I'm telling you, you can start your relationship with Jesus today. If you've never given your heart over to Jesus, you've never given your life to Jesus, today can be the day. So if that's you today and you say, "Pastor Dan, I need help. I want to become a follower of Jesus. I want to become that true kind of Christian that you're talking about so that I can have the help of Jesus to overcome, so that I can have that first love, so that I can enter paradise with Him." If that's you today, would you raise your hand just so I can say, "Yeah, we'll pray for you." Anybody here that says yes? Pastor Dan, it's me. Anyone? Okay, then let me say this. If you read about the Ephesians' lack of their first love, that they're growing dry spiritually, and you said in your heart, "Man, that's me," can I tell you, first of all, that wasn't you saying it to your heart, that was the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit has not given up on you. You may think you're dry and you may think you're separated from God, but you are not. The Holy Spirit is there speaking to your heart, calling you back, saying, "Come on, remember, repent, do the things you used to do." So I'm going to ask you to be brave. If that's you today and you say, "I feel dry. I feel like I've lost that first love, that first passion that I had." If that's you today, and don't be looking around. This is to you. If that's you today, would you raise your hand and say, "Pastor Dan, I feel dry. I need Jesus. Yeah, I see this. Yeah. I have those times in my life as well. Even pastors go through dry times." Let's remember what to do. Let's remember that sequence of actions. Remember how far you've fallen from. Repent of where you are now. and the very practical instruction of do the things you used to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you've seen these people that lifted up their hands. And God, there are those that have, they're just going through that dry time. Maybe they don't feel your presence as easily. Maybe they read your word sometimes and it feels wooden. Maybe they pray to you at sometimes, but it feels like they're praying up against a brick wall. God, help them, if not in their feelings, in their remembrance to know that you promised to be with them and you are still there. So God, help all of us to remember our first love, to see where we are and how far we've fallen, to repent if we're going in the wrong direction, and to do the things that you have called us to do that we did at the beginning. Lord, I pray if there's anybody here that has been reluctant to give their heart over to you, that today could be the day that they also repent to give their lives over to you and believe that you died and rose again to give them a new life, a new heart. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Pastor Dick, would you come?
Well, glory. In the book of Revelation and other places, it says, those who have ears to hear, let them hear. Amen. You've heard, we are hearing the word of God. And it's not enough. Book of James talks about, it can't be just a hearer of God's word, but you must become a doer of it. So we're hearing God's word, and let's apply it to our lives. I love the entire Bible, but in the New Testament, I was sharing with Sunday school. Now that you're born again, now that you're saved, God wants you to live a holy and a righteous life. And he has given you the power through the Holy Spirit to live this life. He hasn't just abandoned you because you gave your heart to the Lord. He's with you every step of the way. He's given you that power. You have ears to hear? Do it. Live it. Amen. Because God is there helping you every step of the way. Father, thank you for your word this morning. Lord, and again, may we apply it to our lives. And Lord, let us always let the center, Lord, our love for you be the center of our lives. Let us not walk away or forget about it, Lord God. And we've done a lot of good things, but oh God, most importantly is our love and our relationship with you. So Lord God, let us continue, God, constantly be reminded, God, that that's where it's at, right there. Lord, my heart is with your heart. So, Lord, we give you praise and glory, and all God's children said, amen. Praise the Lord. You are free to go. Have a great afternoon. Praise God.